But that's okay. We'll start a little early because I don't plan to quit on time. Think about it a while. You'll get there. Good to have you tonight. Glad to have the opportunity to get out. Not sure if it's the weather or just life, but wow, we've had lots of people sick. Still have lots. Some of you are just barely up and going. We're glad that you are if you're here. And if we still have some out who haven't made it. You did not need to adjust your eyeglasses tonight. There is more light in this room. Several of the fixtures have been redone and turned on, so there is more light. They're trying to also benefit the camera production when the online viewing is done. If it's not very bright in here, then the camera has a hard time focusing, so the additional light helps that too. So they're working on our system, trying to make everything together, but hey, my own eyes can stand the light, so not a problem. Our brother Lois remains in the hospital, and I spoke with Dot yesterday, and she said that Lois is not restricted from having visits, but if you go to see him, you will have to gown up in order to go in. Let's begin in prayer, then we'll do our lesson for tonight. Our Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the day. We are grateful for every gift of life. We thank you for watching over us and providing for us in so many ways. We're thankful for the church here at Maysville, for the opportunity we have to gather in this place, away from a day's worth of activities, where we can pause at the conclusion of a day and slow down our minds and our hearts and ponder those things that are important to us for eternity. Father, we pray that you will help us as we live in a world that is very hostile to the concepts of Christianity, to your will and to your word. We pray that you will help us to be strengthened, to be resolved, to serve and live faithfully before you. We're mindful of those in our congregation who have ongoing physical needs. We pray your blessings on Brother Lois Webster, that he will continue to be recovered and will soon be out of the hospital and back doing the things that he would like to do. Father, we have many who are not able to get out, who have either long-term or at least short-term things that are keeping them from being able to be with us. We pray that you will alleviate these, that you will bring them to a conclusion and return our brothers and sisters to us. Father, we're thankful for those who lead us in this congregation, for those who serve in various functions, our deacons, our teachers, those who head up a variety of different works. We ask that you will help us as we live in this life to serve not only ourselves but those around us who we may do good for, especially those who are of the household of faith. Father, go with us through the night. We ask that you'll forgive us of our sins. Help us each day and throughout our lives to keep a tender heart, and that as we recognize those areas in our lives where we have failed or have fallen short, that we will repent. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our lesson tonight is technically chapter 4. But in order for us to do our lesson tonight, chapter 4 begins in the middle of a thought. That thought actually begins back in chapter 3, verse 7, and is going to continue down through verse 11 of chapter 4. So we took about half of the material last week, and I did not introduce it as a continuous piece because I knew there was no way for us to get through. So it was a kick the can down the road with the awareness that I was going to have to come back and put in a few pieces, but I think that still is the better path, all things considered. The next section will begin down in the 14th verse of chapter 4, and that will start a discussion of Jesus, the high priest, so we are going to quit before we get there. Verses 12 and 13 are sort of an aside, a kind of a parenthetical discussion that is not directly relevant to the specific argument of rest that we'll be considering tonight, and we may or may not get to that at the conclusion of our lesson this evening. The concept that begins in chapter 3, verse 7, is the idea of God's rest. We don't talk about God's rest commonly. It is a theme that is stressed really only here in the book of Hebrews, but our author has made it a central discussion. It is pertinent to the Hebrew Christians because he is teaching them that they are likely to miss God's rest unless they change their lives. And some of them obviously were giving up. And so the warnings and the discussion is to make sure they don't miss God's rest, which comes to an immediate question: what is God's rest? And we'll explain that as we go through tonight. I want to begin by reading the text in its total, starting in chapter 3, verse 7, and going down through chapter 4, verse 11. It will be important for us to understand this as one piece, and so we'll try to piece it together. And some of this we discussed last week, and then we'll pick up the rest tonight. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 7 and following. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the day of rebellion. Rephrase, another translation. Do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion, in the day of trial in the wilderness, where your fathers tested me, tried me, and saw my works 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another today, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. While it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. For who, having heard, rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt, led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Chapter 4, continuing. Therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have come short of it. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. For we who have believed do enter that rest. As he said, so I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he has spoken in a certain place of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again in this place, they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remains that some must enter it, and those to whom it was first preached did not enter because of disobedience, again he designates a certain day, saying in David, today. After such a long time, as it has been said, today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day. There remains, therefore, a rest for the people of God. For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his work, as God did from his. Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. Now, that is not the easiest section of material for us to explain and understand. There are a couple of things that make it difficult in it being historical. And it also is a little bit slippery because he changes the definition of the rest and makes reference to more than one thing along the way. So it's a moving target as we find ourselves away. And it is a deep and thoughtful topic. It's not one that immediately applies to a practical application in life. So we're going to have to do some thinking. If we start back, and I'm going to first make the points from last week in an attempt to try to make a very rapid summary statement to connect us to where we're going to spend our time tonight. Beginning in verse 7, our author quotes from Psalm chapter 95, starting in the 7th verse. If you'll go back and read, which we're not going to because you have it here in the text, if you go back and read Psalm 95, you're going to find that the quotation is direct from the text going from verse 7 to 11. Both in the book of Psalms and in the book of Hebrews here in chapter 3. The concept here of rest is a quotation from David's time, but written about the children of Israel as they came out of the land of Canaan, came out of the land of Egypt and into the land of Canaan, or preparing for it. And so God had prepared for them a place, but God swore concerning them that they would not enter that rest. And we understand the background of where they were. In chapter 3, verse 12, brethren, beware lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. It wasn't just that they failed to do something. They were active in their departure. They departed from God in, I think I used the word last week, unfaith. I've altered that a little bit to of non-faith. It might be, and I can lay out a three-step scenario here. It might be the case that someone talks to you and you say to them, I believe you. They've told you something, you understand it, you say, I believe you. It might be that someone asks you a question, and your answer is, I don't know what you're talking about. You neither believe nor disbelieve because you have no understanding, no awareness. The third case, though, represents the other side. And a person might say to someone, as they've given them information, I don't believe you. Now, a person who says, I don't believe you, is not passive. It's not that they have not heard. And it's not that they are lacking belief. It is they have taken a stand or a step of unbelief. There is something that they possess. We might describe it as an idea of rebellion or turning away. It is a lack of obedience, but it is non-belief. Verse 14. I know there's more connection, but we'll have to move along or we won't make it all work out. In verse 14, chapter 3 still, our author says he's addressing Christians, we have become partakers of Christ. All right, we have become, that means past tense, it is something that has already been accomplished. We are now in the process, we are in the state of partaking with Christ. So there is a changed state of relationship, and it is taking place. But then he adds a word in there. If. Big word, two letters, but with very significant consequences. We have become partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence, steadfast to the end. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 7, Paul, writing to this church or these churches and discussing their problems, said, "You ran well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth?" When Paul was speaking to these brethren, they, like the Hebrew Christians, had become believers according to the gospel of Jesus Christ. But they had subsequently been led astray by Judaizing teachers, those who wanted to bring the message of covenant, of circumcision, of certain Old Testament ideas, so that the New Testament Christian had to do these things. Acts chapter 15, verse 1 begins with that discussion, that there were Jews who were teaching that unless a person is circumcised according to the law of Moses, you cannot be saved, so that the gospel was not adequate. So Paul talks to them. What hindered you? You were running well. In the past, you were in a state of serving and being faithful in God. Something happened. And so our author, in chapter 3, verse 14, "We have become partakers of Christ, but you are only partakers if you continue to hold the things of God." Now, that conclusion means that it is possible for a person who was saved, who has come to a place of having their sins forgiven, to be in a state where they are at risk of no longer being saved eternally, which we spoke about that recently, and I'm not going to reiterate all that discussion. Same concept is up in Hebrews chapter 3 a little earlier, verse 6. "Christ as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm to the end." Or from Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, "Be faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life." What if you are not faithful unto death? The promise of eternal life, the crown of eternal life, is promised to those who are faithful unto death. What if one is faithful up until 5 years before they die? You see the problem. Every traveling parent has probably at some point had to deal with children in the back seat who ask the question, "Are we there yet?" And your answer is, "You're not there yet." All right, so as Christians, when are we going to get off? Is it safe to get out of the Christian life? When you get there. Are we there yet? No, we're not there yet. In fact, the Apostle Paul will write and say, "Not that I have already apprehended, but I pursue every day the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." He did not say, it's a done deal. He said, "I'm in the process. I buffet my body daily, lest I, after I have preached to others, should become a castaway." Paul recognized that the Christian life was an ongoing process that required that he remain faithful. All right, that's all background to get us into chapter 4. And then we start in chapter 4, verse 1. "Therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have come short of it." A promise remains. Look at 4:11. "Therefore, let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience." Back up a little bit. Verse 9. "There remains therefore a rest for the people of God." Verse 8. "If Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day." And then back where we are at the beginning. There remains a promise of entering his rest. All right, so our author says we can be in God's place of rest. And we have started. We are partakers of Christ. The conclusion is ours if we hold fast. the second part of verse 1 in chapter 4. Let us fear, lest any of us should come short of it. There's a whole body of religious discussion today that has at its core the intent to remove from the child of God any concept of fear as it relates to God. And there are a number of quotations that would be made from 1 John, perfect love casts out fear, to the book of Romans, chapter 8. There is now, therefore, no condemnation to those of us who are in Christ Jesus. And a number of statements that the quote-unquote once saved, always saved folks use to teach that it is impossible for a child of God to fall from grace. Why did our author in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1, say that we should fear lest we fall short? If it's not possible to fall short, and if that falling short does not put us at risk for our salvation, then there simply is no reason to fear. One then begins to have a discussion regarding the nature of God. And sometimes that image comes up, and people will say, well, if you have this image of a God with, the child of God dangling by a thread over the fires of hell, then your God is not right. And I would not acknowledge such a wild imagery as that. But on the other hand, for a person to say that there is no reason to be fearful of God if you're a Christian means that you're not reading the same Bible I'm reading. Because chapter 4, verse 1, and this is written to Christians, says you should fear. Not only that, although it's going to take us a bit to get there, run over to chapter 10 for just a moment. And verse 30, we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. And again, the Lord will judge his people. Now, chapter 10, verse 31, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hand of the living God. Why? I'll make a personal illustration here. You didn't grow up in my family. If you had, I could ask you a question and you'd be able to answer it from personal experience. But I think you'll be able to answer it anyway. Was my father a gentle, benevolent, nurturing dad, or was he a strict disciplinarian? When I say or, that doesn't apply. He was gentle at times, benevolent often, nurturing a lot. But he also was a very strict disciplinarian. He believed and taught us so under the biblical concept of spare the rod and spoil the child. And trust me, those of you who said I am spoiled, I have evidence to confute that or to refute that. I was very much unspoiled as a child. The idea that we can give an attribute to God that God is one way, that God is so loving, so compassionate, there would be no part of God that would allow God to act toward humans to cause them any harm or difficulty. Do you know where the book of Genesis is? And are you aware of a man by the name of Noah, who was one of eight human beings who lived on the earth that survived the flood that God brought to wipe out humanity? Are you aware that in Numbers chapter 14, chapter 13, as the spies came back from looking over the land of Canaan, that God said to Moses in chapter 14, there are two of you who are going to go into this land of Canaan. Every other person in this group will die in the wilderness. Their bodies will fall. They will not come into this land that I promised them, except for Joshua and Caleb. Two out of the number there is over 600,000 men, not counting women and children. That's our God. That's the same God who is described in John chapter 3, verse 16, that says God so loved the world that he gave his Son for our salvation. Now, which one do we have? Do we have a God who is willing to and going to demand of humans obedience? Or do we have a loving God who is willing to sacrifice Jesus for the sins of the world? The answer is both. Both of these qualities are perfectly in harmony with the nature of who God is. Why should we then fear? Because it is possible for us to lose our relationship with God so that in the judgment day we would be found at fault. Our author says in chapter 3, verse 14, we have become partakers of Christ if we hold fast that confidence. Well, listening to and holding the confidence of our relationship with God means we are obedient to the things God has said. You can't be faithful to God and not be obedient. But let's press on. Chapter 4, verse 2. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. All right. First of all, when we read this, there's probably a misunderstanding that you immediately get. When we see that word gospel, you're going to say, wait a minute. They didn't have the gospel preached to them. Because when you hear the word gospel, what do you think? Perhaps the statement that Paul makes in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Here's the gospel that I preached unto you. Christ Jesus, the Messiah, the Son, who came into the world and died for our sins, was crucified and in the grave, and then raised on the third day and was seen by all of the... That's what the gospel is. Paul says, that's the gospel I preached unto you. When Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the power of God to salvation. What do we mean by that? Well, we mean by that the New Testament concept about Jesus Christ. But the word gospel comes from a Greek combination of words which means the good news or good message. Our word gospel is a hybrid word that over the course of time goes back to the meaning of good words or a good message. So, did the children of Israel hear a good message? The good message from God through Moses was, I'm going to bring you out of the bondage of Egypt and carry you to a land that you own on your own. They were slaves at that time. They had good news preached to them. Did they believe it? Whether or not they believed it or not is up in question. Did they obey God? No, they did not. They did not obey. Did they believe that God was able and capable of bringing them into the land of Canaan? I've referred to it. Let's go read it. Numbers chapter 14. Okay, now we're going to pick up just a little background. Chapter 13, the spies are selected. They've been sent off into the countryside to examine, to see the land, to bring back fruits. They've done that. They return. They give the report. The land is bountiful. Verse 27 of chapter 13, they told them and said, "We went to the land you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey. And this is its fruit." And they demonstrated the fruit. But the people were not willing to go up. Verse 32. They gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land which the spies had spied out, saying, "The land through which we have gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people whom we saw in it are men of great stature." Verse 32. "We were like grasshoppers in their own sight, and so we were in their sight." Chapter 14, verse 1. "So all the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, and the people wept that night. And all the children of Israel complained against Moses and Aaron, and the whole congregation said to them, 'If only we had died in the land of Egypt, or if only we had died in this wilderness. Why has the Lord brought us to this land to fall by the sword, that our wives and children should become victims? Would it not be better for us to return to Egypt?' So they said to one another, 'Let us select a leader and return to Egypt.' Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel. But Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes, and they spoke to all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, 'The land we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. If the Lord delights in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land which flows with milk and honey.'" Now, verse 9, Numbers chapter 14. "Only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people of the land, for they are our bread. Their protection has departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them." And all the congregation, verse 10, said to stone them with stones. Why did the children of Israel not go into the land of Canaan the first time, the group that came out of Egypt? Because they lacked faith. They turned against God. They did not believe God was capable of bringing them into the land of Canaan. And so they heard the good message, they saw the good land, but they couldn't go in. We have heard them a good message of Jesus Christ and about heaven. And we have begun to go in. Those of us who have become Christians have been obedient to the gospel's message. We have believed that Jesus is the given Son of the Lord, the Son of God. Our Lord, the Messiah, has called on us to change our lives in repentance. Change, do differently, think differently, which we have done. To confess our faith, our belief with our own mouth. As Jesus described in Matthew chapter 10, "If a man confesses me before men, I'll confess him before my Father who is in heaven." So we have confessed our faith in Jesus Christ and been baptized in water for the remission of sins. We have begun the process. We have become partakers. But what if we don't hold fast? All the children of Israel came out of the land of Egypt. They all came through the Red Sea. They all ate the manna. They all were provided for by God. But they didn't make it to the promised land. Both our author of Hebrews and the Apostle Paul are going to bring up that particular topic and describe the failure of these folks. But let's go back. They heard the gospel. They heard the good message. But they did not hold to it. And so they became unfaithful. Now, verse 3. "For we who have believed do enter that rest. As he said, 'So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest, although the works were finished from the foundations of the world.'" We do enter. That's not past. Past tense would say, we have entered. It's not past tense. Future tense would say, we will enter. That's not what he says either. He's talking about present. We do enter. We are entering now. It is a process that is ongoing. It is current. It is present. It is continuous. I think I can illustrate that. If I ask you a question about your dining habits, and I said, have you eaten supper tonight? I'm describing something probably that's past tense. May not be for all of you. You may say, I hope to. But if I ask you instead, do we eat? What's your answer going to be? Yes, we eat. Do we sleep? Yes, I'm not sleeping right this minute, but last night I slept. Tonight I'll sleep, I hope. Tomorrow I'll sleep. We are sleeping people. We are waking people. We eat, we sleep. Do you breathe? Yes, we are breathing. Well, does that mean you didn't breathe before? No, we breathed before. We breathe now. We'll breathe. We will continue to breathe. You will live until you stop breathing. What's going to happen if you stop breathing? You stop breathing, there are two other things that are going to happen as well. You're going to stop eating, and you're going to stop sleeping. Now, we could add up a few more things in that list, but these are things that are ongoing, all right? So our author says, we enter. We are entering. We are in the process right now of going in. Don't quit. Don't quit. Now, from this point on, I want to go to the back end and come back from chapter 4, verse 11, and work our way back up and catch up where we are here. I want to back up the argument. So, drop down to the end. Verse 11. Let us therefore be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. All right, there is a particular rest that our author has in mind. That rest. And what are we going to do? He gives three things. We're going to be diligent. What does it mean to be diligent? That means there's something you're going to have to do, something you're going to have to watch out for. Be diligent to do what? To enter. It's something future, but it's going on right now, as he says in verse 3. We are entering. We do enter. Make sure that you keep doing entering. You're in a state of going. Make sure that state of going does not change. All right? Back up to verse 10. For he who has entered his rest. Ah, past tense. Now he's talking about the future, but from a looking backward standpoint. So it is future past. Put yourself forward a time when you look back. When you come to the end of your life, you will be able to look back at the circumstances that you've had. All right? For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his. Question, have we stopped our works? Has our time here completed? Is it time for us to sit and quit? No. When the time comes that we have gotten to God's rest, we will quit, just like God quit. And God, and our author here makes a reference back, which you immediately pick up as being a reference to God and the creation, that on the seventh day God rested because he had finished his creation. When you read this passage, verse 10, he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his. Does that not bring up a passage in Revelation to mind? Revelation chapter 14, verse 13. I heard a voice from heaven saying, yes, says the Spirit, write. Blessed are those who die in the Lord from henceforth. Yes, for they will rest from their labors and their works do follow them. The blessing of eternal life is that we have come to a place where the things of this world are complete. We rest from our labor. Our work will be done. But those works in the past, they're historical. They go with us. When we come to that place of rest, let's make sure we don't miss out on that rest. Verse 10, when we come to that place of rest, our work will be done. Verse 9, there remains therefore a rest for the people of God. There is something still out there. It's available now. It's available to us. It was available to them. It remains. We didn't get the land promise. God didn't promise you any land. God did promise you rest. How did God promise you rest? Well, that's the point of David's citation in Psalm chapter 95. David says, today, if you will hear his voice. Well, it was way past the time of the children of Israel coming into the land of Canaan, so how can he describe that? Jews of the first century were in the land, but now those Christians have this promise, and that promise is God has another rest. It's not the one you've got now. There's something else in mind. Back up another verse, verse 8. For if Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day. Okay, the rest that is under discussion doesn't have anything to do with coming into the land of Canaan. If it did, God would not have written through David in Psalm 95, today, if you will hear my voice, do not rebel like they did. There is a rest that remains. Verse 7, we tie it back in. The day, again he designates a certain day, saying in David, today, after such a long time as it has been said, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Back up to verse 6. Since therefore it remains that some must enter it, and those to whom it was first preached did not enter because of disobedience. And then we go back and pick up the last two pieces that bring us together. Verse 4. For he has spoken in a certain way, in a certain place of the seventh day in this way. And God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again in this place, they shall not enter my rest. Now, as we have backed our way up, what rest does God have in mind? What is it that our author is trying to get us to understand about this rest? I want for us to conclude in an unusual way. I want to go back to where we started at the beginning and put all of this together. Now, having discussed all of these pieces, listen as they fit together. Hebrews 3:7. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. In the day of trial in the wilderness where your fathers tested me, tried me, and saw my works 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end. While it is said today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. For who, having heard, rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt, led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear, lest any of you should seem to have come short of it. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them. But the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. For we who have believed do enter that rest, as he has said, so I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he has spoken in a certain place of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again in this place, they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remains that some must enter it, and those to whom it was first preached did not enter because of disobedience, again he designates a certain day, saying in David, today, after such a long time as it has been said, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day. There remains, therefore, a rest for the people of God. For he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works, as God did from his. Let us, therefore, be diligent to enter that rest, lest anyone fall according to the same example of disobedience. Thank you for your time and attention. Lord willing, next week we will continue our discussion in verse 12 of Hebrews chapter 4. Thank you.